In this video, we'll explain how to extend your on-premises data center to Microsoft Azure. We'll walk through the data center extension reference architecture diagram to help you understand how it can help you with your own data center extension. In this video, we assume that many organizations have experimented with Microsoft Azure at this point by implementing some virtual machines for proof of concepts, dev test environments, or even production applications, using other Azure services such as storage, backup, or site recovery services. They probably have one or more Azure subscriptions. They may or may not have connected Azure to their on-premises network. They may be using Microsoft accounts to manage their subscriptions rather than organizational accounts. Note, if you're so new to Azure that these terms and concepts are foreign, check out the introductory information at http://azure.microsoft.com/campaign/supercharge-with-vms/, then watch this again. Many organizations are ready to move beyond experimentation or some initial projects and actually integrate their network, name resolution, Active Directory, and identities with Azure so they can treat it as an extension of their on-premises data center. So now what? Many would probably start by asking themselves, what would that even look like? Our goals are to provide a diagram of what it would look like by bringing together many Azure design concepts into a single diagram, paralleling the Azure design concepts to on-premises design concepts to help bridge the less familiar with the more familiar, not overloading the diagram with a lot of text, provide ability to interactively learn more about parts of the diagram by turning parts of the diagram on and off, viewing detailed example implementation data when needed, learning about design and implementation guidance by clicking on objects in it. So let's take a look at the diagram. While the diagram might not look like much now, don't worry. We'll have a lot more in it over the course of this video. The first thing to know is that the diagram is interactive. For example, by hovering over the question mark, a bubble appears with additional information about the object in it. I won't cover the details that appeared because we'll be covering them throughout this video, but hovering over just about every object in the diagram, including lines, will present a bubble that contains additional information about the object. If we take a look at release notes, we can see the release version is 3-31-2015. This is important to note because new features are constantly added to Azure, so depending on the date you're watching this video, this information may already be out of date. There is also some additional information about the goals of the release here. If I were to hover the mouse over the diagram legend text, we'd see additional information about the use of different colors and shapes in the diagram. We won't look at these details, though, because we'll cover all that information throughout the video. So, without further delay, let's see more of the diagram. During the remainder of this video, we'll look at what a data center extension for Contoso, which is a fictional organization, looks like. As we can see, when I put my mouse pointer over the word layers, a list appears. By checking and unchecking items in the list, I can show or hide parts of the diagram. This is helpful if you just want to see or learn more about specific parts of the diagram. I'll start by clicking on the on-premises security zones layer. Moving my mouse pointer back to layers and then off the layers box closes the layers list. Now you can see some additional objects appearing in the diagram. In this case, an on-premises data center and three gray boxes with text to the right of them. The gray boxes represent security zones. Many organizations use the concept of security zones so that they can define security policies that are applied to the servers and data within them. Policies can also be applied to network traffic that enters and exits the zone. In our on-premises data center, we've illustrated perimeter, internal, and storage security zones. These are similar to zones that might exist in your organization. Hovering my mouse over the word perimeter causes a bubble to appear with some information in it, like the fact that only servers that need to be accessible from the internet reside in this zone. You may not have noticed, but the type of information that appeared in this bubble is different than the type of information that appeared when I hovered over the question mark earlier. The same type of data will appear when you hover over objects of the same type, though the values for the data types will be different. The data types will be different across different types of objects. There's a spreadsheet that includes all the data that you'll see here in the diagram, as well as additional data you can't see. For example, in the spreadsheet, you'll see common security policies often defined for each security zone, even though you don't see it displayed in the diagram. You can download and modify this spreadsheet for your own environment if you like. You'll also notice that when I put my mouse pointer over the word perimeter, a blue line appeared around the gray box and some white space to the right of it that represents the perimeter security zone. Now let's add the Azure Security Zones layer to the diagram. Organizations can define security zones and policies in Azure too. You can see that after turning on the Azure Security Zones layer, the diagram now also shows Microsoft Azure in gray boxes within the same highlighted box as we saw just a moment ago when we turned on the on-premises security zone layer. As you can see, many of the same concepts that you're familiar with today on-premises can be implemented, albeit in different ways, in Azure, if you choose to. Keep in mind that security zones are just a concept for defining policies, and that those policies apply to servers and data. We'll add the on-premises applications layer to populate the diagram with some servers. The servers are represented in boxes in the on-premises data center. The images in some of the boxes have the same icons, and some are the same color. At this point, we don't know what the icons and colors represent. Based on the data that appears when I hover over this box, we can see this is the presentation tier for application 1, because that's what's listed in the role description in the bubble. I can also see a little more about what this server's purpose is by reading what's listed in the details section, as well as information such as Active Directory domain it belongs to, its cluster IP address, the type of hardware resources it utilizes, and other information. Note that the hardware specified is aligned to an Azure virtual machine configuration, even though it's an on-premises server. The Azure hardware configurations are used on-premises because Contoso plans to continue migrating its servers to Azure, and it knows it'll be easier to do so if their server configurations are already aligned to the Azure configurations. The information we provide about Contoso is only to serve as a detailed example of what commonly exists on-premises data centers. Your data center configuration will likely have several similarities and differences from this example. Before we go on, let me explain a little more about what we're looking at. The little icon on the server in this box represents the role of the server. From the data we just looked at in the bubble, we can tell that the role of the server is that of a presentation or web server. Thus, all servers in the diagram that have a globe icon are presentation servers. From the role description, we can also tell that this is part of presentation tier for application 1. In this case, the light purple color of the server is used to represent application 1. All other servers that are this color also support application 1. Notice that the server is represented with a box around it. The box around the server means that this server is running in a virtual machine, not a physical machine. It could be run on a physical machine instead. If it were, it would be represented without the box around it. You can also see that it's really a stack of two boxes. The top box contains the server image, whereas the bottom box is just an outline. This illustrates that for the presentation tier for application 1, we're using two servers running in virtual machines, not one. Throughout the diagram, when you see stacks of servers, the stack represents the minimum number of servers that are typically used to provide the server role with high availability. In this way, if one server performing the role were to fail, at least one other server would survive to provide that role. Additional servers could be used to provide even higher levels of availability or scale for the tier. For example, since this server is the same color as the last one, we can assume that it's also providing a server role for application 1, though since it has a different icon, we don't know what role it is yet. By hovering my mouse over the server from the role description that appears, I can confirm that it does indeed provide a role for application 1, and that role it performs is that of Business Logic Server. I now know what the icon for Business Logic Servers is. We now know what two of the icons represent, but what about the third one? Let's take a look at that last icon. Since this server is a different color from the last two, we can assume that it's not supporting application 1. It has a different icon, so let's learn more about it. Based on the data for the role description that appeared, we can confirm this server supports application 2, not application 1. We can also see it's a database tier. So now we know that the icon means. From the data in the bubble, we can see that this is a SQL Server Always On Availability Group, which is used to provide high availability for the application's database. At any time, you can click on many of the objects in the diagram, particularly the objects on the Azure side. Doing so will open a new browser tab and load a design or implementation article about the object. In this case, a new tab opened with an article about SQL Server Always On Availability Groups, so you can learn more about them. So far, we know that there are two applications, each with a presentation, business logic, and database tier that are deployed in an on-premises data center. Remember, earlier we looked at the detailed information for the perimeter security zone. Given each zone's security policies, we know why different server roles are deployed in different security zones. In this case, Application 1 is used by the public over the internet, and Application 2 is a private application that's used only by Contoso's employees. In your organization, you probably have several applications of each type. We can deploy applications to Azure in a similar manner. The dark purple servers support application 3, and the teal servers support application 4. Let's look at the data on one of the Azure servers. In addition to the information we saw for the on-premises servers, we see information that is unique to Azure, such as Azure availability set name, the Azure cloud service name, and the Azure subscription name. If you have already experimented with Azure, then you've probably come across these terms, but you may or may not have understood their purpose in the larger scale context. You'll find that each tier of each application is in its own cloud service and in its own availability set. Since we're looking at the presentation tier for App 3, you see that these servers are part of the Contoso App 3 subscription. If we take a look at the data for the presentation tier for App 4, we see that these servers are part of the Contoso App 4 subscription. You'll find that all tiers that support a single application are in the same Azure subscription, but that different subscriptions are used for each application. Contoso has been using this strategy because it makes administrative assignment and isolated billing easier for them because the monthly costs for each application are paid for by different departments in their organization and are administered by different people. Contoso is aware of the newer Azure Resource Group concept, which they believe may enable them to change their subscription strategy. But they have not had enough time to investigate it enough to know for sure yet. Similar to what you see on premises, the tiers of each application are represented with the same color. However, on the Azure side of the diagram, the color also represents the Azure subscription that the objects are part of. We'll see some additional objects that are the same color and subscription shortly. All tiers for each application are deployed together in the on-premises or Azure data centers in this diagram. This doesn't have to be the case, though. Contoso could certainly have deployed tiers of each application in either data center, and likely will in the future, based on different requirements and objectives. Now let's move to the next layer. Like many organizations, Contoso uses Active Directory on-premises for user authentication and for centralized management of its servers. Here we have a stack of two Active Directory domain controllers. Of course, the servers in this stack are not load balanced, but are communicated with by users and servers in the internal security zone. Looking at the data for these servers, you can tell that their domain controllers in the internal.contoso.com Active Directory domain. These servers also serve as DNS servers for this DNS zone. All servers in the internal and storage security zones are members of this domain. Here we have another stack of two Active Directory domain controllers. Looking at the data for the servers, we see that their domain controllers for a different domain, the perimeter.contoso.com Active Directory domain. These servers also serve as DNS servers for this DNS zone. All servers in the perimeter security zone are members of this domain. This domain trusts the internal.contoso.com domain, though it's a one-way trust only. This enables Contoso's administrative staff to manage servers in all security zones using a single Active Directory account. If their perimeter domain were compromised, the attacker could not use credentials from that domain to do any harm within the internal domain. Just as we have domain controllers on-premises, we can also have them in Azure. These are domain controllers in the internal.contoso.com domain, and they replicate with the on-premises domain controllers for the domain. Like their on-premises counterparts, they also serve as DNS servers, and all members of the internal security zone that reside in the Azure data center are members of the domain. The internal domain is effectively stretched across the on-premises and Azure data centers. It's helpful to have domain controllers near the servers that use them in both the on-premises and Azure data centers so as to minimize latency in communications. This setup also enables each data center to work without a dependency on the other. Like their counterparts in the on-premises perimeter.contoso.com domain, these domain controllers are members of the same domain, and all servers in the Azure perimeter security zone are members of this domain. It's important to note that all of the Azure domain controllers for both the internal and perimeter domains are associated with their own Azure subscription. These subscriptions are separate from the subscriptions that the servers that support the Application 3 and Application 4 are associated with. The reason for this is that the people who administer the domain controllers for Contoso are different than those that administer the servers that are associated with the Application 3 and Application 4 subscriptions. Moving on, we've already talked about the applications and their database tiers. The database servers could store their data locally, but typically databases are stored on high-performance centralized storage somewhere in the organization. And this is what Contoso does. Some servers now appear in the on-premises storage security zone. These servers are part of a scale-out file server cluster. Notice how these aren't represented with boxes around the servers. The reason for this is that Contoso has implemented them as physical servers, not virtual machines. This cluster provides low-cost, high-performance database storage for the database servers. Now let's look at storage on the Azure side of the diagram. Azure provides its own storage, so we don't have to implement and manage storage servers or storage arrays. Like the servers we looked at previously, the storage is color-coded based on the subscription with which it's associated. Each subscription utilizes a single Azure storage account. A storage account can include tables, queues, blobs, and files. Before creating any of their virtual machines, Contoso pre-created a storage account for each subscription. When Contoso created the virtual machines in each subscription, they specified the appropriate storage account. Azure created a blob storage container called VHDs within each storage account, which is what we're looking at now. It then placed a virtual hard disk file for each virtual machine within the container. Within the same storage account for each subscription, Contoso created an Azure Files file share to use as a file share witness for their SQL Server always-on availability groups. This met their needs and was less expensive than creating another virtual machine used solely to host a share to serve as a file share witness. Note that when this video was recorded, Azure Files was still in preview release. The service doesn't provide a service level guarantee until it reaches general availability. Watch for future announcements to know when it reaches general availability. Now that we've seen all the servers and storage in the infrastructure, let's talk about the network that connects them all. We can now see the on-premises network backbone for Contoso. We see that it's connected to the internet through a router. We also see several network switches which connect multiple individual network segments that comprise the backbone. When I hover my mouse over one of the switches, we can learn a little more about it. We can do the same with one of the network segments. Sometimes it's a little hard to get the mouse right over the line, but whenever you do, you'll see details for whichever segment you've hovered over. While simplified for the diagram, your network probably looks similar to Contoso's. By turning on layer 10, we can now see network segments connected to the on-premises network backbone. We can see that in some cases, a single server role is on its own segment, like the perimeter domain controllers. In other cases, we see that multiple server roles are on the same segment. This is the case with the presentation and business logic tiers of Application 2. Contoso did that so that they could implement network access controls to network segments rather than to individual servers. This is done to reduce management overhead for maintaining network access controls. When we turn on the on-premises network access control layer, we see that Contoso has two firewalls on their network. One controls network traffic between the internet and its perimeter security zone, and another controls traffic between the perimeter and internal security zones. So if we go back and look at the perimeter domain controllers again, we see Contoso dedicated a subnet to them because they wanted to control network access by allowing only DNS and domain controller communications to them. They combined the presentation and business logic tiers for App 2 on the same segment because they allow the same ports to them, which are TCP 80 and 443, since both tiers are web servers. Contoso implements its access controls on the subnet level rather than on the individual server level because it minimizes the amount of firewall rules they have to maintain. This approach also prevents them from needing to make firewall rule changes every time a new server is added to a segment. Contoso could further control access with access control lists on each side of the switches, but they are not at this time. Now let's look at the Azure network. We can see that the Azure network is connected to the internet. It is also connected to Azure storage. We can also see a firewall. The Azure firewall provides port filtering, DDoS protection, a distributed virtual firewall, and IDIPS technologies, all of which protect the Azure network and all its customers from the internet. Contoso doesn't connect their virtual machines directly to the Azure network. They first had to create a virtual network. That's what they connect their virtual machines to. You'll see that a multicolored line appeared over the Azure network. The line is made up of three smaller lines, each color-coded for the three different Azure subscriptions that Contoso has. Hovering over it, we can see that it represents multiple virtual networks as well as a DNS server defined for each one. Azure automatically configures any virtual machine that you connect to a network with the DNS server you specify for the VNet. Contoso configured a VNet for each of its three subscriptions because a VNet cannot span subscriptions, and they needed application 3 and 4 servers to be able to communicate with the domain controllers on the INF network, though the application 3 and 4 servers didn't need to communicate with each other. We can see the names they gave to each of the networks here. To enable cross-VNet connectivity over site-to-site VPN connections, Contoso implemented Azure high-performance gateways. These high-performance VPN gateways provide up to 200 megabits per second connectivity between their VNets. Though shown as a single gateway, in reality, it's three separate gateways, because if you want to connect a VNet to another one, each network you want to connect must have its own gateway. This multicolored line is a subnet that's auto-created by Azure to connect each of the three virtual networks to its respective gateway. Like on-premises, Contoso is able to create network subnets on the Azure virtual networks too. The subnets we see here are also color-coded to match the virtual network and subscription that they're a part of. Similar to their on-premises approach, part of the reason Contoso segmented their network the way they did was to enable them to implement network access controls on subnets rather than managing controls for individual servers. Though they use firewalls on-premises, in Azure they use network security groups, which are represented by these red funnels to control access between subnets. When I hover the mouse pointer over one of the network security groups, you can see more about them. But what we don't see is the source, destination, and port roles configured for each of them. This information can be found in the spreadsheet using the link at the bottom of the diagram. Contoso configured network access control rules using network security groups that are similar to the rules they configure on their on-premises firewalls. We've covered network connectivity, so now let's talk about how we do load balancing to all these different stacks of servers, at least the stacks that are load balanced anyway. We can see now that a bunch of tridents have appeared. These represent on-premises load balancers. On-premises, Contoso uses hardware load balancers to load balance traffic across the servers in the stacks where we see load balancers. We don't see load balancers in front of the perimeter and internal Active Directory domain controllers or the scale-out file server cluster because traffic to these servers is not load balanced. In Azure, we load balance the same types of servers as we did on-premises. Here we see a load balancer in front of the App3 presentation servers and the App3 business logic servers. Note that they're different colors. One is blue, the other is dark gray. In Azure, external load balancers are used when traffic from the internet is load balanced to servers. When I hover the mouse pointer over the blue load balancer, we see it's an external load balancer. When we want to load balance internal traffic that does not come from the internet, we use internal load balancers. These are represented in gray. When I hover the mouse pointer over the load balancer in front of the App3 business logic servers, you see it's an internal load balancer. The other load balancers used by Contoso in Azure are also internal load balancers because Contoso doesn't allow internet traffic to these servers. These servers are accessed only by internal traffic. Like on-premises, they're not load balancing the domain controllers on the Azure side either. So we now see servers, storage, and networks that Contoso has implemented in similar ways, both on-premises and in Azure. Now let's look at some supporting infrastructure that Contoso has only on-premises, because they currently have no need to have similar infrastructure in Azure. Contoso needs to support public DNS services. They have two sets of DNS servers as seen in the diagram. The first set consists of DNS resolvers. These servers resolve internet host names for all of Contoso's internal servers and PCs. Both the internal and perimeter domain controllers that also serve as DNS servers forward DNS requests to these servers using one as a primary and the other as a secondary DNS resolver. The other DNS servers are DNS advertisers. They resolve the names of Contoso's internet-facing servers for name resolution requests that come from the internet. Okay, so we have infrastructure in place on premises and in Azure. But by now, you're probably wondering how the servers in the two data centers communicate with each other. This is where our site-to-site network connections come in. Contoso had two primary options for connecting their on-premises network to their Azure virtual networks. The first option was to use a site-to-site VPN using the Azure High Performance Gateway. This would give them up to 200 megabits per second bandwidth between the two data centers, where the traffic travels over the public internet and is secured with IPsec. The other option was to use Microsoft ExpressRoute. ExpressRoute would provide them with up to 10 gigabits per second bandwidth, where the traffic travels over a dedicated WAN link between the two data centers and not over the public internet. Like most organizations, Contoso wanted to start their data center extension with acceptable connectivity, a basic infrastructure, and some initial applications. As they add more applications to Azure, they plan to migrate to an ExpressRoute connection. However, with either option, they'll use the Azure VPN gateways to connect their Azure virtual networks together over the Azure Network Fabric. We've now covered what Contoso put in each data center and how they connected the two data centers. Let's now talk about the server administrative experience a bit. To administer the servers in either data center, Contoso administrators log in with their internal.contoso.com Active Directory domain accounts. However, with their Azure servers, Contoso's administrative staff has an additional layer of management to contend with. That's because they need to log into the Azure Management Portal to create and manage Azure objects, such as virtual machines and networks. When you set up an Azure subscription, you connect the subscription to an account. The account could be a Microsoft account, such as jimd@outlook.com, or an organizational account, such as jimd@contoso.com. The downside of using a Microsoft account is that if a person sets up organizational resources using that account and then leaves the company, the control of the Azure objects goes with that user. Given that, it's likely you want to connect organizational accounts to your subscriptions. To do that, there are a few steps you need to complete. Those are illustrated on the next layer. The first step is to set up an Azure Active Directory tenant. If you're currently using Office 365, you already have one of these. If you were to click the link for the Azure Active Directory here, a new tab would open with an article about how to set it up. The next thing you need to do is install and configure the Microsoft Azure Active Directory Sync tool, which is running on a dedicated server here. Note that it's running on a single server, not on multiple servers. If that server were to fail, you would replace it with a new server. Finally, you see this dashed line. The directory synchronization server communicates with the internal.contoso.com servers and synchronizes the accounts to your Azure Active Directory tenant. The arrowhead is only on one end of the line, since this is a one-way synchronization from your on-premises directory to Azure Active Directory. If you want your administrators to use the credentials when they log into the Azure Management Portal that they use to log into their on-premises resources, then you can synchronize passwords with the accounts. This provides the same sign-on experience. The administrators are actually authenticating to the on-premises resources and the Azure resources using two sets of credentials. They just happen to have the same usernames and passwords. If you want to enable single sign-on between on-premises and Azure resources so that your administrators can authenticate once and administer on-premises and Azure resources, then in addition to synchronizing your directories, you also want to federate your on-premises Active Directory with your Azure Active Directory tenant. In this scenario, You might choose not to synchronize passwords, since it's unnecessary when you federate. After adding the federation layer, you see some new servers and lines. I'll explain how federation works in a moment, but let's start with what it does in our scenario. Imagine I'm an administrator at Contoso. I come to work in the morning and log into my PC using the Active Directory username and password I normally use. When I'm ready to work with my Azure resources, I open the browser and go to the Azure Management Portal. I won't be prompted for authentication credentials if I'm federated. If there's no federation in place and I just synchronize my on-premises Active Directory with Azure Active Directory, I would be prompted for credentials. So what's happening here? Let's assume you set up Windows Server Web Application Proxy and the federation servers like we have in the diagram, and that you federated your on-premises Active Directory with Azure Active Directory. You can read guidance on how to do this by clicking on those servers. After federating, when the administrator goes to the Azure Management Portal, he doesn't use the default URL, which is manage.windowsazure.com. Instead, he uses manage.windowsazure.com/contoso.com. The portal parses a URL, extracts the contoso.com domain name, and redirects to Azure Active Directory, passing the contoso.com domain name to it. Azure Active Directory looks up the ADFS server for contoso.com and redirects the browser to the web application proxies. The web application proxies communicate securely with the federation servers through the firewall. The federation servers then validate credentials with the internal.contoso.com Active Directory servers. Once credentials are validated, they're passed back to Azure Active Directory and back to the management portal, and the user is logged in. Of course, this multi-step process is transparent to the administrator when the federation is in place. This layer enables you to see the server roles of all the servers without needing to hover over each of them. Until you familiarize yourself with the diagram, you might find it helpful to toggle this layer on and off. This layer should be used only when all layers containing servers or storage are turned off. Otherwise, the diagram will be too difficult to read with all the layers turned on. Like layer 22, this layer provides the detailed network information you're interested in without needing to hover over every object. This layer even includes information about the tiny network segments you see in the diagram. You might periodically configure the layers this way to get a big picture view of the network details, or maybe even print it off separately. With all the text in this layer, you'll need to increase the magnification of the browser so you can see it better. Note that when we do this, the text gets bigger, but not blurry. That's because we use a scalable vector graphics file for this diagram. So we've now been through the entire diagram. We plan to update the diagram on a regular basis based on your feedback and with additional functionality. I want to emphasize how important your feedback is in influencing where we go next. Please take a few moments to rate the content. And on the download and video pages, please ask questions and provide feedback, as we'll watch these and respond regularly. Be sure to check back occasionally to see when new versions of the diagram and video are released. Under additional resources down at the bottom of the page, the first link is to a video, which is the one you're watching now. The web page for the video has links to go to the portions of the video where each layer is discussed. There's also a link to download the script that was used for this video. You can also download a version of the Visio diagram that was used to create the diagram on this page. You can even edit the Visio file after you download it. Finally, you can download the Excel spreadsheet that contains all the data you saw in the diagram, as well as additional data that isn't in the diagram. I've mentioned that a few times, so I'm going to open the spreadsheet and show you what I mean. The data we saw for each object in the diagram are recorded as values in the columns for specific rows in the spreadsheet. Here we see the detail column. which appears for all servers shown in the diagram. What we don't see in the diagram is what's in this expanded detail column. This is due to the fact that we can only display so many characters of text in the diagram. Not all rows in the expanded detail column have data, but where we thought it was necessary to provide some additional detail, we've done so in this column for some of the rows. When you see these gray boxes, that's just telling you that we didn't forget to put data there, we just didn't have any relevant data for that cell. You might also find comments in cells. They're the ones with the red triangle in the top right corner that provide some further information. For example, look at the hostname column header. By viewing its comment, you get more detail on what naming conventions were used for the servers. Though I'm sure you already have your own naming conventions, you may still find the examples useful. Most of the comments are found in column headers, though in some cases you might find a comment in a specific cell if we thought it was helpful to provide some additional information about that specific cell. In some cases, you'll find entire worksheets of data that were not represented in the diagram. This worksheet contains rules configured for each of the network security groups, or NSGs, which were represented with the red funnels on the Azure side of the diagram. The data that we saw in the diagram was about the NSG itself, but not about the rules configured for it. All that data is contained on this worksheet. We know which NSG from the diagram that each rule is applied to because it's specified in this column. Most of the information we see in the spreadsheet is required to configure each of the items through the Azure Management Portal or PowerShell. You might decide to keep the worksheets in columns, but replace all the cell data with information you use for your own data center extension. So now you've seen how to use the interactive diagram in the spreadsheet that accompanies it. If you'd like to learn more about Azure, there's a great free course that was presented in December of 2014 that goes into deeper detail about many of the topics we discussed today. If you haven't experimented with Azure, we encourage you to take advantage of the free one-month trial to see how fast and easy it is to implement different parts of the diagram that we covered in this video. Thank you for your time, and good luck with your data center extension into Microsoft Azure.